Okay, so hello everyone, I'm Jason Voegele. Mentioned in the intro earlier that I work for Basho and do Erlang programming for a living, but that's kind of a recent development for me, and before that I did many years of Ruby programming, and tonight I'm going to be talking about some topics that interest me in the Ruby world, which is kind of a deep dive into the Ruby object model and its reflection capabilities, which is Ruby's ability to like kind of tell you about itself at runtime, and also using that information to do what we'll call metaprogramming. So getting into that, I'll just start by saying that mostly everything I'm going to say tonight has come from this book. So if you find any of it interesting at all and you want to learn a little bit more, you should check this out, published by the Pragmatic Programmers Press. Really good book. And I learned a lot from reading it, and hope that some of that comes through in the talk tonight. And the first thing I want to talk about is just what is metaprogramming. And the first thing that came to my mind was kind of like code that writes code. But as I was thinking about that, that reminded me of like static code generators and compilers, and that's kind of what they do. And I don't really consider what those things do to be metaprogramming. So. The book that I just mentioned defines metaprogramming as writing code that manipulates language constructs at runtime to kind of differentiate it from static compiler type code generation. And that might include things like defining classes on the fly, adding methods to objects, or wrapping them with your own custom logic or behavior, and even going so far as creating your own DSLs, domain-specific languages. And some of those talks, or some of those topics, are going to be later on in the talk. But first thing we need to know comes from our own Jeff Lane here. The first rule of metaprogramming: don't do it. Jeff said I could use that, and there is a lot of truth to that. Some of the things I'm talking about are pretty advanced techniques, and you probably don't want to go to them as the first thing you want to try in solving a problem. Benefits of being Facebook friends with Jeff. You get to mine his photo history. So, but anyway, you don't want to use this as your first approach to tackling a problem, but there is a lot of value in some of the things we'll see, and if the simpler approach isn't doing it, then we could turn to some of the tricks we'll explore tonight. So, now, we define metaprogramming as manipulating language constructs at runtime. And in order to really understand what metaprogramming is, you have to kind of understand what those language constructs are and how they are represented at runtime. So I'm going to spend a good bit of time going through those things, the Ruby object model, methods, blocks, classes, and all these kind of things. And I know a lot of the Ruby veterans out there probably are really familiar with this information. But we're going to start at the surface and work our way down and get pretty deep into this stuff and figure out how we can manipulate them. So, and also, if anybody is not overly familiar with Ruby, if you feel like I'm going too fast through some of this stuff, just stop me, ask questions, add color commentary, whatever you feel you need to do. We'll slow it down a little bit. But first thing we need to understand is that everything that exists at runtime in Ruby is an object, although there are some sort of exceptions. Some things are not full-fledged objects, which we'll come back to later. But most everything is a true object of Ruby. And if you look at the source code of the Ruby interpreter, at least in Matz's Ruby interpreter, to see, you'll find a structure that looks something like this. Pretty simple structure. It's got a pointer to the class of the object, which is its type. It's got a couple flags in there, such as whether the object has been tainted or frozen or anything like that. And these two items here, the numIV and the IV pointer, basically represent an array of instance variables. So that's all there is, really, to Ruby objects on the surface of it. Is anybody surprised by anything that's missing out of this list? Methods. So in Ruby, methods don't actually live in objects, even though Ruby sometimes makes it appear that they do. Methods always live in classes. So, where was I going with this second bullet point? Okay, so methods live in classes, and in Ruby, you can ask an object for its methods, and those kind of correspond to the instance methods of the class that it's derived from. So in Ruby, objects all have a class, they have a single class, and that's where the methods for that object live. So if you want to know what kind of methods an object responds to, you have to kind of turn to its class to figure out that information. So Ruby has a number of methods to tell you that kind of information. So you can call .methods on any object, and it'll tell you all the methods that that object responds to. On a class or a module, you can call instance methods method, and that will return all the instance methods, which pretty much correspond to the methods of the objects defined by that class. And you can even do nice things like turning methods into objects at runtime. So methods aren't actually objects in Ruby until you ask them to be. And we'll actually show a little example of that here. So this is actually going to be a pretty code-heavy presentation. So I'm going to fire up my tmux session here. On the left, we've got the one true editor. And on the right, we've got pry. Does anybody not know what pry is? Okay, so pry is like a Ruby REPL or console. It allows you to type in Ruby expressions, and it will evaluate them and print out the results of those.
So it's kind of like IRB?
Yes, it is a better IRB, I would say. So it's got some nice features on top of IRB. So what I'm going to do here is, over on my editor on the left, I've got some code, and I've set things up in such a way that I can tell that code to evaluate over on the right-hand side. So that's why I've got this kind of two-pane setup. So what we're looking at here is just a simple Ruby class, Schrodinger box. It's got one method called peek. And the idea here is that if you know your quantum physics, if you look inside of Schrodinger box, the cat is either going to be dead or alive at that point in time, once you look inside the box. And so we're kind of representing that here. But the point I'm trying to make is how Ruby handles instance variables. In Ruby, they spring into existence as you create them. They're not like Java, where they're predefined in your class declaration, and that's all the instance variables you have. Whenever you need a new instance variable in a Ruby class or object, you just create one, assign a value to it. And let's take a look at how this works. So we'll evaluate this little bit of code. All right, so that's defined our class in our pry session. And then we're going to evaluate these two lines here. So first, we'll create a new instance of that Schrodinger box and ask it for what its instance variables are. And you can see it returns an empty array. So this line here is what we evaluated, boxed on instance variables, and it returned an empty array. However, once we evaluate this box.peak line, that's going to call this method we have defined over here, and it's got a 50% chance of the cat being either dead or alive. And let's see what happened with this guy. So now when we ask our box what its instance variables are, it returns that it has a cat instance variable, and in this case, the poor cat is dead. Sorry, kitty. Yeah, so sad. And finally, down here at the bottom, I've just created a separate instance of this Schrodinger box. And the only point here is that instance variables are not shared between objects of the same class, right? So each object has its own separate copy of its instance variables. So pretty basic stuff about Ruby objects. So let's see what's next. So we talked about what methods are, that they live in classes, and we'll come back to classes in a little bit. But before we go in there, I want to talk about blocks a little bit. So this is something that's often confusing to newcomers to Ruby, but the basic idea is pretty simple. A block is just a chunk of code. It can be between do and end pair or a pair of curly braces. And that's just a chunk of code. Then Ruby keeps that around in memory, and you can store it for later consumption or invoke it immediately. And the one extra feature that Ruby provides for blocks is that you can kind of tack on a block to a method call. And when you call a method, that method, if it has a block with it, you can turn around and yield into the block that's passed into it. And we'll show some techniques you can use with that. But by default, like methods, blocks are not objects by default. But you have a few different ways that you can turn them into objects using any of these three operators here, proc.new, the lambda keyword, which is a synonym for this little stabby looking arrow thing, or the ampersand operator. We'll look at examples of all of those. And an important point about blocks is that they're closures, which is another concept that kind of trips up people who are new, but really it's a pretty simple concept. A closure is just means that this block of code can refer to things on the outside of it, and it kind of bundles them up into its own local scope, and even if that block gets passed around to different parts of the program where those variables are no longer in scope, it kind of carries along with them. And we'll eventually see some examples of that. And lambdas are just a special kind of proc. You hear proc and block and lambda kind of thrown around interchangeably, and they're mostly the same, but there are some important technical differences that we'll get into here. I think I'm in the wrong file, excuse me. Nope, I just forgot to show my examples for methods, so. All right, we'll quickly run through this. I got ahead of myself on the slides versus the examples. This is just Ruby methods. Anybody who's done Ruby programming has done this before. You can create methods with the def keyword or use some of these Ruby shortcuts like adder accessor. So that will define a couple methods. But the point I wanted to make with these is that you can kind of ask Ruby what the methods are at runtime. So if you have a person class, and in that person class, you've called adder accessor, that defines a pair of methods for each attribute you put in there. You can also create private methods, and Ruby allows you to inspect what those private methods are. You'll see over here when you call private methods, it returns boo. And you can even call those using the send operator. And I don't know if anybody's seen this before. Ruby has a built-in method called caller. It allows you to examine the stack trace of whoever called you. So that's a nifty little trick you can find out for debugging purposes, maybe who's calling your code. So my boo method there is just taking the top five of whoever calls me and printing it out. But the most interesting thing here is when you turn a method into an object. So we evaluate these bits of code here. M equals me.method, and it takes email as a parameter. So what that's doing is asking the me object, which is of the person class here, and returning a method object that represents the method named email. And once you have that, you see you can get some interesting information out of it, like what is the name of this method, who's the owner, what class owns it, even who the receiver is. That's basically the object on the left-hand side of the dot when you call it. And you can even find out the source location where that method is defined. So these are some handy things you can do when you have a method object. And a nice thing about pry, oops, I used the wrong name. I called it M. Pry has the ls feature to list contents of things. So these are other things you could do with method objects if you have them. Okay, and sorry for the diversion there. I was talking about blocks. So I mentioned blocks are things that you can pass to Ruby methods here. So I've created this method called tap. This already exists in Ruby, but it's something that wasn't there in the early days, and a lot of people wanted it. But it's really easy to define yourself if you're using an older version of Ruby. But what this thing does is if you call tap on an object, that object will yield itself to whatever block you give it, and then you can do all kinds of things with that object, and then in the end, it returns the object after all the changes you've made. So you can see an example of how that's being used down here. So we call tap on this string that happens to say foo, and then the block we pass to the tap method manipulates this foo object a little bit. It appends the string bar to it and upcases it. And you can see after that's evaluated, you get a capitalized foo bar string. Well, the point here is that's really easy to define in Ruby. Any method can take a block into it, and you call that method, or call that block by using the yield keyword. And you can check if the block was given here and yield conditionally if you actually have one or not. So you can kind of pass control back and forth between blocks and methods in Ruby. So that's a very basic usage. Another usage you'll see a lot in Ruby is capturing blocks as an object. So this is one of the syntaxes I mentioned, how you can turn a block into an object is the ampersand syntax. So when you pass a block to a method, if that method uses this ampersand syntax, it kind of bundles that block up into an object that happens to be of class proc. And it can store that for later usage. So like in this example, if we pass a block to this events initialize method, it's saving it for later. And then if you happen to call this something happen method, it calls that stored proc object with an argument here. So we can see how this works. So there we define our event class. And here's a usage of the event. We call event.new. And this is the block. This is the block that we're passing to event.new. It's just going to put some message to the screen whenever it gets the callback. So let's define our event and then call something happened on it. And you can see that it printed out that message. Again, very basic usage. Got a few other examples down here of the different syntaxes you can use for turning blocks into objects. Proc.new is one of them. Down here is the lambda keyword. And you can see my editor changes that into a lambda symbol. Sorry if that's confusing. Or you can use the stabby lambda syntax, which is that arrow. Those last two are equivalent. But point is here, you can take a block and turn it into an object with these different methods. So any questions about that? It's confusing. Kim? Yes, but it's not necessarily up to date. So I will check on that. All right. So moving on. Classes. All right. This is in Ruby, every object is an instance of exactly one class. But Ruby has some interesting properties with classes. One is that classes are actually objects, too. So every object has a class, but classes also happen to be an object. And therefore, they also have a class themselves. And that class is called class with a capital C. So there's a Ruby class called class, and that represents objects that are classes. So it's a little mind-bending. But the name of a class, for example, string, is just a constant in Ruby that refers to that class object at runtime. Another interesting thing about Ruby classes is that they're kind of a scope operator. And when you're inside of a Ruby class, that's actually executable Ruby code. You can do pretty much anything inside of there that you could in any other part of a Ruby program. It's not like a static declaration. And when you are inside of that class definition, the keyword self refers to the class object that you're currently in. And also, you can create classes dynamically with class.new, not used very often, but occasionally from time to time, you might want to do that, and we'll show a little example of that. So let's take a look at classes. Okay, so here we're just showing that Ruby, all Ruby objects have a class method attached to them, so you can call .class on any Ruby object, and it'll tell you what class it is. So let me clear out my prior here, so it's a little easier to see. So let's evaluate those things. So the class of this foobar thing here is string. The class of string with a capital S is class, because string is a class. That means the string object, its class is class with a capital C. Class with a capital C also has a class, which is itself, and its class is all the way down here. So, and here's an example of how classes are kind of like executable scopes. So in here we just have a regular class, but inside we're not doing the normal things you would do with a Ruby class, such as defining methods. We're just calling put statements, but we're putsing what self is, so that can be a little illustrating here. So we'll evaluate these guys. All right, so here's our class definition, or our class in Ruby that prints out some various information about it. So self, as you can see, is just a constant that refers to the name of the class. And of course, since it is a class object, its class in turn is class. And one thing that I found interesting is that even before you're finished with the class definition, you can call new on it and create objects of it. So that's something I kind of learned while playing around, that class isn't even really fully defined yet, but you can already go ahead and create objects on it and probably do interesting things with it. That's what that shows there. And this is just an example of using class.new instead of the class keyword. It works the same. If you pass class.new a block, you can do all the regular class type things in there, define methods, or do whatever else you would wish with a class. But since you're passing it a block, that means it's a closure, and it's a little bit more dynamic than a regular class definition is, because you can pull in information from the outside world if you need that to help build up your classes. Okay, inheritance, another kind of standard concept in all object-oriented languages. Ruby is single inheritance language. You have exactly one superclass for every class. If you don't say which superclass is, it's object. And the root of the inheritance hierarchy is basic object. So object, in turn, inherits from basic object, which is a smaller object with fewer methods in it. And you can ask Ruby for this information at runtime. With the superclass method, it'll tell you what the class superclass is, or even the entire chain of ancestors with the ancestors method. And we'll come back to an example of that. But what that tells us is how Ruby finds its methods. So this illustration, by the way, was totally stolen from the book I mentioned before, but kind of shows how Ruby finds a method. Let's say you're calling my method on some object obj. What Ruby needs to do to find that method is remember that objects themselves don't have methods in them, only their classes do. So it first looks to the right to find that object's class, and if it sees that method in there, it will use it. Otherwise, it's going to traverse upwards through the inheritance hierarchy to find the method. So nothing surprising there, I don't think. It's just standard inheritance, but they call that the right and up rule sometimes, because it looks right to find the class and then upwards through the inheritance hierarchy.
Could you repeat what that was again?
I'm sorry?
Could you repeat what that was again?
The right and up rule. So you move right to find the class. That's the right arrow. So you have an object, you ask it what its class is, and then the up refers to the inheritance hierarchy. So it's moving upwards through the inheritance, the ancestors chain there. Make sense? Kim? Oops. Okay, so another part of the Ruby object and class model is modules. In some ways, they're really like classes. In other ways, they're not really. They allow you to define methods inside, and they, just like classes, they offer an executable scope. But in other ways, they're completely different because you can't create objects from classes. And they don't really participate in the inheritance hierarchy. You can't have a module inherit from another module or class, or vice versa. But you can include them in the inheritance hierarchy in other interesting ways. So some languages have multiple inheritance, where a class can inherit from more than one parent class. Ruby doesn't allow that, but modules allow you to kind of simulate that. And the two ways in which you can do that, one is include. This just, when you call include some module when you're inside of a class definition, it puts that module in the ancestors chain. So part of the inheritance hierarchy for that class or module. And it inserts it in the ancestors chain directly after the class or module that called include. And we'll show an example of this, so if that doesn't make sense, bear with me for a moment. Prepend is a newer addition to Ruby. This only exists post Ruby 2.0 or maybe even 2.1. This is a nifty little trick that allows you to insert the module into the inheritance hierarchy before the thing that calls it. So you're basically telling this module that you're prepending that I am now your superclass, so to speak. So that's kind of a weird concept, but effectively what it means is it changes what the super means. So you can call a super version of a method, meaning go up the inheritance hierarchy to find the superclass version of that. This kind of flip-flops that when you call prepend and kind of turns it upside down. Yeah. It's done with classes. You can use it anywhere, or you could use include. So did I say class? It's modules. So a class can prepend a module.
So I could have my string and prepend string and become the superclass string?
I think you could do that, yeah.
No, the string isn't a module. You can prepend or include a module into another module or class.
Yeah. Which reminds me of another nifty little thing I learned. Remember we said classes, these are just constants that refer to the class object at runtime. If you really want to fuck with Ruby, change what string means and just change it to anything else. And Ruby will allow you to do that. Constants aren't really constants in Ruby. You can change them. It'll give you a little warning and say you probably shouldn't do that, but you can. And so now what? So what is foobar.class now? Oh, not so good. Stack level too deep, so.
Brings a new definition of dynamics.
Absolutely. All right, so I think I now have to kill my prize session because that did bad things. Oops. All right. Okay, so we were talking about inheritance and module inclusion and prepend. So first the basics. Here we have a couple empty classes, a base class shape, and a class circle that inherits from shape, thus making it a subclass. So when we evaluate those two things, of course you can call dot superclass on anything, and you can see that we call it on circle, and that returns its superclass shape. But you can also call ancestors on it, which gives you the whole inheritance hierarchy back up to the root. So starting at where you are, whatever your receiver was of the ancestors call, it'll start there and working to the right or downward in the way this is laid out. You go upwards through the inheritance hierarchy until you reach the root, which is basic object. So this tells us that circle inherits from shape. Shape inherits from object. We've got this weird PP object mix in here. That's something that gets inserted by pry. If you were running this in a real Ruby interpreter, you wouldn't see that. Pry inserts that in there somehow. Kernel is a module that the Ruby object class, object with a capital O, includes in it, where most of those common methods like puts and printf and all those things are defined. And then finally, basic object is at the very top and has very few methods. So that's the ancestors chain for our circle class here. So here's where we can see what the difference between include and prepend are. So we have this module drawable. And in our class square, we include the drawable module. If drawable actually had any methods, those would now be available in the square class. In triangle, however, we call prepend on it. And that does something different, which we shall now see. So we've defined our module drawable. And in square, we include it. In triangle, we prepended it. And now when we look at these guys, ancestors chain, you can see how they're different. So square has the drawable module on top of it, so to speak. This is kind of drawn in reverse order. Whereas triangle, the drawable comes before itself. So we will see how to use that to good advantage a little bit later. But keep it in mind for now. And I kind of got annoyed by this PP object mixin being in my ancestor chain. It kind of muddied things up for me. So we'll look at our first monkey patch here. I'm going to redefine what the ancestors method actually does. So as we all probably know, Ruby has open classes. You can open up a class at any point, redefine a method, have it do what you will. If you need to call the original version of the method, what you can do, one way to do it is to alias the method, give it a different name, as I've done here, and then call that method on the original one. So what I've done here is just redefine ancestors so that it calls the original ancestors method, but takes that PP object mixin out of the list. So as I evaluate that, get it in my prior session, now if I come back here and look at these guys, you can see that that object mixin has been removed from the ancestors list. So we'll actually come up to a better way to do that using prepend a little bit later. But that's the simplest and most traditional way to do this kind of monkey patches.
Does it change prize behavior without
its permutations? I think just because the list got shorter, it put them all on one line instead of down the screen. Yeah.
Probably a pretty printing extension thing.
Yep. So the PP object mixin is probably the thing that is doing that printing in that format. And I just removed it out of the ancestors list display, but it's actually still in there doing its work. But we're just not displaying it in my monkey patched version of ancestors. So.
I was imagining it calling ancestors on itself for some reason.
All right, and this is just one other example I came across. I won't go too much into detail about this, but one interesting about Ruby is you can inherit from classes that are defined dynamically, which is kind of a cool trick that this camping web framework uses. So you can see over here it's inheriting from this thing. What this is actually doing here is capital R is a method defined by the camping framework. And this slash help is a parameter to that. And it uses, this method uses that parameter to create a class on the fly. And then your class kind of inherits that. So the class you're inheriting from doesn't even exist in the text of your source code. It's just something that gets constructed on the fly in memory. And this is the only place I've ever seen that done. But it is something you could do if you so choose. But yeah. So I don't think we need to look at how that actually works, but know that it's there if you want it. All right, any questions about include or prepend or inheritance or method lookup? Okay, we got a trivia question. Here we've got this class C. Inside of it, we've got a method called M1. And inside of that method, we are defining another method called mysterious. And finally, down at the end, we have a class D that inherits from C. So the question is, where is mysterious defined? In what class does it exist at runtime? And how can we call it? Yes, almost. You are right that it... Okay, so here it is in source code. Let's clear this out again. All right, so we'll go ahead and evaluate our classes C and D. And right now we can ask C what its instance methods are. And by the way, the false parameter there just says don't traverse up the inheritance hierarchy, just show me the methods that are actually defined in this class itself. So what does that tell us? It's got only an M1 method, so mysterious isn't there at all. However, let's create a new instance of D, which inherits from C, and call our M1 method on it. Now that we've called this method, Ruby has gone through and executed that other nested def statement we have and defined the mysterious method. But the interesting bit here is, how does Ruby know in what class to define it? Well, it uses the current class concept. So even though we're calling the M1 method on an instance of D, the actual declaration happens when we are in class C, and so that's where the method ends up being defined. So now you can see when we call instance methods on C, that method has come into being dynamically. Yeah.
Can you flip back to my picture where it says don't do this?
Yeah. So keep that in mind. This is just a trivia question. I have actually created nested method definitions in the past, and I didn't understand this, and I kind of got it wrong. You do closure, so you know that you can have your functions let in your current scope, and that can be sometimes useful, and I've tried the same concept in Ruby, but it doesn't work exactly the same because the method isn't really defined inside this other method. Even though it's nested textually inside there, it's really defined on the containing class, but only happens to be defined once you call the method that nests it. So, yeah. It doesn't. I was just trying to throw you for a loop. Because
okay.
if I asked what class is defined and there's only one class in the diagram, it makes it too easy, right? So, but the idea here is that D is a subclass of C, and you're calling M1 on an instance of D. So I guess it's not something that would necessarily follow that method definition would be up in C. So you kind of have to think about that a little bit.
From what you were saying earlier, that the method definition is a closure, so it's going to go apply back to wherever it was defined, right? Or is it doing something different than that?
No, methods are not actually closures. Blocks are. And methods defined with defined method that take blocks are closures, but methods with regular old def are not. They're a little bit more of a static construct. Yeah, if we pass false, that's because it's not looking up the inheritance hierarchy. If we did not pass false or we pass true, it gets everything going all the way back up to object, and you can see M1 and mysterious are both in there. So it is in C, but therefore by definition it's also in D. All right. So that's mostly just trivia. We got one more trivia slide later on. Brings us to next topic, which is also a little bit confusing for some people, singleton methods. I said before that Ruby objects don't actually have methods. They just point to a class that has methods. Well, Ruby actually allows you to find methods on individual objects. You can take a string and say def string.foo, and it will have that foo method. That one string object only, not other strings of the same class. So you can take any object, and you can define methods that exist only on that one particular object. They're called singleton methods. And you actually use this all the time, even though you might not realize it, because class methods in Ruby are actually singleton methods. Because classes are objects, if you define a class method, what you're doing is defining a singleton method on the class object for that class. Clear as mud? Right. It'll probably look better in code. Because a singleton method would have had like the object that you're defining it on as that object dot mysterious, and we didn't have that. So like, if you wanted to make a singleton method out of here, you would say, yeah, or self, and of course, nope. The fact of what self is kind of implicit, but putting that self dot on there actually means define a singleton method for the object that self refers to.
So when you call M1, self would be the instance of the thing.
Yes. Yep. That's why it's not actually self that's defining where mysterious is, it's the idea of the current class. Which
no,
you don't have any handle to in Ruby, actually. It would be on. It would be a singleton method of, in this case, the new D object. All right. So yeah, let's dig into that. So that's kind of the next thing we're talking about is singleton methods. All right. So here we've got a string object. And by the way, if you think I'm weird for putting semicolons in my Ruby code, this was actually on purpose because pry echoes the value of whatever expression you type in on the terminal, and sometimes I don't want that because it kind of clutters up output, so don't judge me for my semicolons. but anyway, we've got a string object here, and this syntax is how you define singleton methods in Ruby. So you say def. You give it the object that you want to define the method for, and then dot, and then the method name. So let's evaluate that. And now this one and only string object now has an exclaim method that will add an exclamation point to itself, basically. And you can see that down here. Note that even though this foobar is an identical string, in terms of its content, it's not the same string object, so this one will not have that singleton method defined on it. Now define it on what?
A symbol.
Oh, yeah. You mean right here?
Oh.
Okay, so so I mentioned way back in the beginning that some Ruby objects are more object-y than others. Symbols are one that are less object-y than others. And another one is fixed nums, which are Ruby's small numbers that are less than, what is it, 2 to the 7th, I think? Anyway. Okay. Yeah. So whatever size it is, if the number is smaller than that, Ruby represents it as a fixed num. Internally, so it's more efficient. But some of these things, symbols and fixed nums and maybe some others, do not play the singleton method game. So you can see here that try to define a singleton method on a symbol and Ruby just won't let you do that. Sorry, won't work.
Does it work for a really big number?
Let's find out. Oh, I gotta say def. Def that thing dot foo. And we'll just.
Yeah, I didn't like that it was more than
All right, so we could say our int equals da 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 da. Oops. Yeah, I could do that. So if we say def int.foo puts self, and no, apparently you can't. What is int dot class? Big num. So.
Okay, so big num's still in the word.
Apparently not. I'm a little bit surprised by that, actually. I suspected that would work.
Emergent behavior.
Yeah. So we're learning as we go. All right. So you've seen how we can define singleton methods on some objects, maybe not all. You can ask Ruby what the singleton methods are on any particular object. And in this case, we've got one. It's that explain method we defined right above. And I mentioned before that class methods are nothing but a special type of singleton method. Here I've got a class called foobar and two separate class methods using two different syntaxes. So we're saying whenever you define a singleton method, it's object.method. In our case, we're defining a singleton method on the foobar class. Remember, classes are objects, so they can have singleton methods too. And since we are inside of a class definition, self means the same thing as foobar in this case. So these are just two different ways of defining a singleton method for class. And you see we can call those. And we can also ask foobar what its singleton methods are. So Ruby doesn't really have class methods. I don't think there's like a dot class methods method anywhere that'll tell you the class methods because they're already generalized into the singleton method concept. Make sense? Okay, so now we talked about, or I mentioned asserted before earlier that Ruby objects do not have methods, and what we just did kind of makes it look like they do. So the question is, where do these singleton methods live? They can't live on the class that the object comes from because then they would be shared with other objects of the same class, right? And the point of singleton methods is they belong to an individual object. So Ruby invents a concept called singleton classes, which are used to hold these singleton methods, among other things. So in Ruby, each individual object can have its own singleton class in addition to the class that it came from. So if you have a string, its class is string, but as soon as you add a singleton method to it, the singleton class kind of gets created as needed to hold these singleton methods. And you've probably seen the syntax before down here. You can kind of get inside to the singleton class of any object using this class less than, and then object on the right. Usually you'll see that as self because you most often see it in class definitions where you're trying to get into the singleton class for the class itself. But it doesn't have to be that. It can be any object you want, and this allows you to break into the singleton class for that object. And let's see how that works. Okay, so here is the same example from the last section, except now we're using the alternate syntax here. So remember we said you can define singleton methods by saying object.methodName. Well, another way to do that is kind of get into the scope of the singleton class for that object and then just define the method. And that's what we're doing in this case. So the difference here is that in this case, we're actually in the scope of the singleton class, and you can see that self in this case, when you use this syntax, self in this case refers to the singleton class for this particular object, and it has a weird name, an unpronounceable name, but this is what singleton classes tend to look like. That hash symbol kind of indicates that it's a singleton class for a string object.
Does that show up in the ancestors?
No, it does not. Because Ruby kind of lies to you with the ancestors. It doesn't include the singleton class anywhere visible. It's there, it uses it, but you can't see it with its reflection capabilities asking for the ancestors. And we'll get to a diagram that kind of lays it all out and shows, but you can't get to that information at runtime. And over here, this is the same foobar example. Before, we were saying def self.class method or def subar.class method. Here, we're just opening up the scope of the singleton class for this foobar object and defining the methods that way. Okay, and you can see the singleton class for foobar is this pound class colon foobar, so it's a singleton class for a foobar object. All right.
So are those methods stored as instance variables of that meta class, or how is that?
Not necessarily as instance variables, but yeah, they are stored in that singleton class, which, as you referred to, are sometimes called meta classes, sometimes called eigenclasses, but Ruby's technical term for them is singleton classes. They're all the same thing. But yeah, the methods are stored. Like I said, all methods in Ruby are stored in some class. But when you define a singleton method on an individual object, Ruby creates this singleton class to have a place to put those so that they don't interfere with other objects of the same class. Well, let's find out. We'll have a thing that is a block. I don't think I even need those. Puts, what am I? All right, so there's our thing that is a proc, happens to be a lambda in this case. So let's try to thing.foo. It looks like you can. So what happens when we call thing.foo? All right, so we got our foo from, and self in this case is the proc object. So yes. I don't think I'm going to go too deeply into this one, but I thought this was an interesting quote from the book there at the top. Is every single day, somewhere in the world, a Ruby programmer tries to define a class method by including a module. And many of you here have probably tried to do that, and it doesn't work. Rails invented this concept of concerns to kind of address this kind of thing. And at this point, we should probably all understand why is that when you're including a module, you're inserting that module into the ancestors chain of the class where you're including it, but that defines it as instance methods, and class methods are really part of the singleton class for that object. So if you actually want some module that has some methods in it and you want to include that as class methods in your class, then there are two different ways to do that. One is to kind of open the singleton class, like what we did here, and just call include some module. And since you're doing the include in a singleton class, that makes it kind of like class methods for that class. Or Ruby has a purpose-built method to do the same thing, which is extend. You can call extend on any object, which could be a class. And it basically adds the methods from the module into that object. And I've got examples of that if anybody wants to see them. I don't know if you really want to go into this, but is this interesting information to anybody? Or should we move on? Yeah. All right, that might be interesting, okay. Extend self. So remember, what extend does is takes a module and adds the methods from that module to the object that's calling extend. In this case, you know, this is the same as self.extend, right? And self in this context is our math module. So what's extend self is doing is taking the methods from self, which is math, and adding them to the object math. So another way of doing that would be this doesn't quite work, but maybe it gets the concept. Well, this is what we should do. Include math. Because self would mean something different inside of there. But effectively, what you end up when you do this is this allows you to have a module whose methods are both instance methods and class methods at the same time. So when you define a method like this cosine here in a module, that makes it an instance method. You can only use it by like including that module into a class as an instance method and then calling it from within the context of an actual object. But sometimes you want to just call it like math.cosine. It doesn't really have any state. It doesn't really need to be bundled with an object. And maybe you don't have a class that you really want to include it to. So extend self allows all these methods to be available as either like mix in through include or calling it through the module itself. So let's go ahead and look at this. We'll define our math module. It calls extend self, so now we can call math.cosine on it. Of course, the more traditional way of using a module like this is to include it in some class, and then, of course, the method is available on instances of the class. Same thing. Or finally, maybe the most interesting use of extend is that you can kind of add capabilities to objects dynamically. If anybody's ever heard of DCI, data context interaction, I think it's an idea promoted by the guy who initially came up with Model View Controller. He's trying to promote this way of developing software where your objects are just dumb data holders in your source code, and then at runtime you attach their capabilities to them on the fly on a per use case basis. So like for this use case, this object needs these extra capabilities, so define them there, but then when you're done, make them go away. And in Ruby, you can kind of do that with extend. So on this line, let me clear out pry again so it's easier to see. So first we just created an object. Any old object will do. Then we call extend on that object with the math module, and that has the effect of taking the methods from module math and inserting them into the object, and then you can of course call the cosine method on there. So, and actually if you look at the Rails source code, it uses this extend self a lot, and I'm not sure why in all cases, but if you look through their source code, you'll see that a lot, and you'll know better than I did what it does when I first saw it. So.
So if you do extend self at the beginning like that, I assume that that's dynamically putting it into the class hierarchy or whatever. Right?
Yep.
Because like that method wasn't even defined when you did this.
Right. So I intentionally put it at the top because when I first saw it, I always saw it at the bottom and kind of assumed it had to be that way. But no, it doesn't. You can put it right at the top and it works. Okay, so we've been talking about singleton classes, and singleton classes are classes. Classes are objects, and objects have singleton classes. So know that singleton classes themselves have singleton classes, and those singleton classes also have singleton classes, and it goes on forever and ever and ever. And if you ever find a use for that little tidbit of information, let me know, because I don't think anybody ever has made use of that, but it's there. Just makes the model more consistent.
You said a bunch of words and there was just
dogs on it.
Doge. Should we just leave it there for the rest of the night?
Wait, I got some happenstance.
Oh. Ah, sorry. All right, our second and final Ruby trivia slide. We have an object, let's call it O. This object does not happen to be a class. It's any other object, but not a class. What is the superclass of O's singleton class? O has a singleton class. Since it's a class, it has to have a superclass. It could be. I didn't make the question specific enough, so that is technically correct based on what's stated here. But the more complete correct answer is the superclass of the singleton class of an object is the object's class. Yeah. All right. So O is an object of some class. Let's say it's a string, because that's simple. O's singleton class must have a superclass. It uses O's class as that superclass, in this case, string. So if O is a string, then O's singleton class has a superclass of string. But that's not all. If C is a class, what is the superclass of C's singleton class? So this is almost the same question, except it's a special case where C is itself a class. So in our previous example, O was a string. This time, C is some class. Let's, you think it's C? Pretty self-referential. The answer is the superclass of a singleton class of a class is the singleton class of the class superclass. All right, so let's say our C is the string class now. We're not talking about an instance of a string. We're talking about the string class. Its superclass is object. So the string class also has a singleton class associated with it. That's how you define class methods or singleton methods on the string class. That singleton class also has a superclass. Since the object that owns that singleton class is itself a class, Ruby looks upward one level to make the superclass of the singleton class.
So any class method on object can be called by the class.
Bingo. Exactly. And see, that's the point I made right here. So Jeff was prescient. This is what allows you to call superclass singleton methods even when you're not in that class itself, is because of this arrangement. So this is another picture straight out of the book that kind of displays all that information we were just talking about graphically. So over here you have an object. It is of some class. It's got a singleton class. The superclass of that singleton class is the class of this object, D. D itself is a class, which means it's also an object, so it also has to have a singleton class. And remember from our Doge slide that this could go on to the right forever and ever and ever and ever. Ruby doesn't actually instantiate all those Doges, by the way. It creates them as needed, so you don't run out of memory. And so the superclass for this singleton class is going to be the superclass of that guy's singleton class. So you can kind of imagine this parallel universe here is your normal Ruby classes and methods. And over here on the right, you've got this parallel dimension of all your singleton classes. What's that?
The Platonic ideal.
Yeah, exactly. So this is the more complete picture of Ruby's method lookup. So if you call some method on this object, it has to potentially go through quite a bit of work to find out where that method actually lives. But
if you're new to Ruby, don't let this scare you. It's kind of cool.
You can do a lot better.
Yep. So this is, again, more of the trivia part. But all right, let's move on. We've kind of covered pretty much everything I know about in terms of the Ruby object model and how classes and everything fit together. So I was going to start to go into some of the kind of metaprogramming facilities. And the first and probably most well-known is this method missing concept. So we just saw how Ruby finds its methods by going through that complicated hierarchy. What happens if it doesn't find one that matches the name? Well, it calls this method missing method that is defined way up at the top of the inheritance hierarchy. And by default, that method just throws an error. But you can override that in your subclasses to do custom behavior. So if you override method missing, you can make your object respond to any old message you wish and not have to have methods defined to do that. And this technique is often called ghost methods because they don't really exist. And they can be fraught with peril. For one thing, you can ask Ruby objects the respond to question. Say, do you respond to this method name or this message? And if you have a method defined with that name, Ruby will of course say, yes, I do, even if it comes from a superclass. But if you do this ghost method thing, that doesn't really work because respond to will say, no, I don't respond to that message. But at runtime, your object is actually going to end up making some legitimate response to it. You can work around that by also overriding this respond to missing method. So if you override method missing, you should also override respond to missing to make sure that those things agree with each other and that respond to will no longer lie. But it's usually more trouble than it's worth since there are better mechanisms. And the other important downside is that these ghost methods, you can't discover them at runtime with reflection. Like you can't say, what methods do you respond to, and that will never show up in the chain or the list of methods that thing responds to or has. Like if you're in Pry, for example, and you type ls object, these ghost methods won't show up in there, so it's not documented very well. But all that being said, there are occasional good uses for these ghost methods. This is the builder gem by our beloved Jim Wyrick. This is a rather old Ruby gem, but it shows one good use of using method missing that I know is the purpose of this is to kind of allow you, it provides a DSL for creating XML markup in Ruby code using a syntax like this. So you can say builder.person, and you give that a block, and then in there you say, it passes the builder object into the block, and you call b.name on it and b.phone, and it ends up creating this XML-like structure here. And that's all done with method missing, because this builder object can't know what XML tags you're going to want to use, so it can't define a method for every single XML tag, because that's an infinite list, so it uses method missing to capture that. And basically, method missing gets the name of the method that was tried to be called and also the arguments that were passed to it. So you can use that information to kind of do fancy things like that. So I won't get into the source code. It could be interesting to study if you're interested, but there's a lot there. But any questions about that? Alrighty, let's move on. Often a better approach is define method. Ruby not only allows you to define methods with the def keyword, but it's got a define method itself that you can call on any class or module object. And that takes a name and a block, and it makes the method available in the class or module where you called it. And this can be used for defining like families of really closely related methods that they almost are all the same, but they have little slight differences, and you can kind of account for that in by creating these methods programmatically. So let's take a look at a quick example of that. So here is, so we all know that Ruby has built-in methods called adder accessor, adder reader, adder writer. And what those do is you give it a list of names, and it generates, well, adder accessor at least, generates a pair of methods for each name that you pass it. If Ruby didn't have that built in, it would be very easy to define. And this is the basic approach of what you do. So we've got this module called attributes. And it's got a method, a single method in it called attributes. Actually, let's look at how it's used first. That might be a little bit easier. It's this line right here. Just call attributes and give it the list of names, just like adder accessor in Ruby. So you can see what this does here is just goes through the list of names that you passed it. And for each one, defines two methods. We call define method once. That parameter there is the name of the method that you want to define. And that happens to be the name of the attribute. So in this case, it might be name. And all this method does is calls instance variable get. So Ruby says to hell with encapsulation. You can always get into the innards of an object very easily, but you can use that to your advantage. So we're defining a method. It calls instance variable get. And it returns that. We define another one that is the writer method. And that's the same name as the attribute, but with an equal sign appended. This is what gets called when you assign to that attribute. And that uses instance variable set. So this is basically what Ruby's adder accessor methods do internally. They may or may not do it in C code, though. I'm not sure. I haven't actually looked. But you can see how that's used down here. Here's a use of extend on a module, because we want this attributes method to be available in the class. So include would make it an instance method and wouldn't do us any good in this case. So that's why we use extend. And another really quick example is, let's say you have like an HTTP client. There are all these different HTTP verbs. They almost all do the same thing. They submit some request with a request method. So you can use define method to define the different get and put and post and delete. And they, in turn, just call the request with the method passed in. So that's that technique, I think, is actually used in HTTP party. Make sense? It's now 8 o'clock. Do we usually stop at 8, or do we go to 8:30? I've got just three more slides and some examples to go along with them. So if carry on, okay. Okay, that was define method. That's pretty standard. This one is a little bit more interesting. Prepend we introduced earlier, and we said that it inserts a module into the ancestors chain before the thing that calls it. Well, it turns out that you can use this technique to kind of replace what the monkey patch thing we did earlier, where we wanted to get rid of that PP object mixin from out of our ancestors chain. So defined an alias for the original ancestors method, created our own monkey patched ancestors method, and used that alias to call it. Well, prepend provides a better way to do that, because with prepend, it redefines what super means. So you can have let's say we want to override the ancestors module, or the ancestors method. We can create a module that has its own ancestors method, and inside of it, we can call super. And with the magic of prepend, super now refers to the original ancestors definition. And I will show how that works in just a second. But the advantage to doing this is that first, you don't have to create some artificial alias for the original methods, such as original ancestors or anything like that. Super is that alias for you. And more importantly, it serves kind of as documentation, because a lot of times Ruby libraries will do this kind of crazy monkey patching, and you have no idea where your methods actually came from. If this library is monkey patching this and the other one's doing that. This one, with this technique, your code is in a module, and it will appear in the ancestors chain for your for whatever object you're calling the method on. So you can see right there, and you can even use method objects to kind of get at the source location, and it will very clearly point to the actual definition. So this is, for that reason and probably others, this is now the kind of the preferred way of doing like method wrapping kind of monkey patches. So let's kind of see what that looks like. We're going to look at the same example from earlier where we want to override the ancestors method. This one I've added a little bit more diagnostic information into the method, but the basics are the same as before. We want to get rid of this PP object mixin out of that list of our ancestors. So we're going to call super to get the original list, and then we're going to call reject, which will return a new array that doesn't have that item in it. But you can also see here some interesting debugging techniques. What we're doing is, on that first line there, m equals method with double underscore method. Well, what we're doing here is we're calling the method named method. That's predefined in Ruby, and it takes a method name and returns a method object from it. This syntax here is just the name of the current method. So if you're inside of a method anywhere in Ruby, that syntax will give you the name of that method as a symbol. So this will turn out to be colon ancestors at runtime. So that gives us our method object. And then once we have that, we can print out various information of what the name of our method is, what the owning class or module is, where it's defined in source, and I think most interestingly, this super method. So if you have a method object, you can ask that object, what is the super version of your method? Meaning, if this method called super, where would it go? So that's just some diagnostic information I put in there. But you can see how we kind of do the monkey patch here is we just open up the class called module, and we prepend our module overrides module to it. And that will have the effect of any methods in here will be overridden, will override the version that was in the module class itself. So. All right, so let's make sure it works. We define all the things. And actually, I'll clear that out. And then when we execute ancestors, now we can see that the diagnostic information is being printed out first. And then we get our ancestors list without the PP object mixin. So the method is ancestors, as we suspected. The owner is module overrides. Even though we called it on string and it was originally defined in the module class, our version that actually got called came from this module. Source location, well, if this were actually Ruby text files, this would point to some file on your file system with a line number, but since we're running in pry, it doesn't give as much information there. And finally, the super method. This tells you that the version of this method that would be called if you called super comes from here, the module class, effectively.
I thought you said you would see module overrides in the ancestors tree. Is that because you're overriding ancestors itself?
I did say that. Why don't we?
It's calling super and then enumerating on that. And it's
module side of the
ancestors. Oh. What? How about this? There it is. Because, yeah, that's not part of the hierarchy for the string class. So I think I misspoke earlier. It's not necessarily visible in the ancestors chain for what you're calling it on. But the
chain of the class.
Yes.
That's what modules would be.
Yeah, I'll need to think about that one a little bit more.
Sorry,
yeah. No, kernel is. Module is a class that kind of is outside of the string hierarchy. So, well, we can see what it is.
Class inherits from module, it looks like, right?
Yes. So pretend we didn't just prepend our module overrides. The module ancestors chain would be, well, module itself, that inherits from object. Object includes kernel, and also inherits basic object.
So if you hadn't prepended, it would have been after module in that list?
If I had done include instead, yeah. And I think now that it's been prepended, include will not have an effect. Because Ruby kind of examines the ancestors chain before doing the include or prepend. If it already exists in the chain, it doesn't add it again, even if it's at a different position. So I'm calling include module overrides, but my guess is that's not going to have effect because it's already in the ancestors chain. So it's not going to add it again, and I don't think it will move its position either, but let's find out. So, yeah, correct.
You can also call those as like module.prepend and module.include instead of within the context of the class definition. Is that right?
Yeah.
I was just wondering if you've heard of that in the case where it doesn't actually change.
So let's say. Yeah. So yeah, you'd have to say string.send and let's say prepend. And then the argument would be module overrides. So yeah, you can't call it directly like Rob said because it's private, but yeah, it still works. Okay, so yeah, I need to think about the documentation aspect a little bit more. I was a little presumptuous there, but I suspect that it would show up in the stack trace probably. Let's maybe that's what I need to do is put a caller colon here. Or we'll see. And we'll redefine all that. Okay. And I think I just want a fresh pry session. So define all those things. Now we call ancestors tmux scrolling. I don't remember. How's it work? Oh, I just scroll. Okay. So I actually think put s would have been better than p in this case. Yeah. Anyway. I'll come back to that. I don't want to. Yeah, so as I'm thinking about it, this is the wrong place for caller anyway, I believe, because we're already inside of here, so like our caller wouldn't include ourself, right? Anyway, let's not get lost in the weeds. Next topic is eval. So we're starting to get into the power playbook for the metaprogramming wizards here. Eval is actually a family of methods. You've got a regular old eval defined in the kernel module available to everywhere in Ruby. It's a pretty blunt instrument. Got some potential security concerns. You generally speaking want to stay away from it, but it allows you to take a string of code and evaluate it. And that can be used for good or ill, but there are better tools for the job. One is class eval, which evaluates a block that you give it in the context of a class. So you call class eval on some existing class, and it'll evaluate your block of code within the scope of that class. Self will be that class, and the current class will also be that class. So if you define methods in there, it'll end up defining them on the calling class, which will probably work better in code examples rather than words, so hold off on that. And then instance eval allows you, you can call instance eval on any Ruby object, you pass it a block, and you've basically injected your block into that object, and you can do anything with it that you want. You have access to all its instance variables, you can call private methods without having to resort to send. Self is that object that you called it on, and so this is a common like debugging tool. I can imagine that Pry might use this technique. So like Pry allows you to CD into an object, and you can call that object's methods. Like, what do we have in here? Oops. All right, we'll just make an object. Pry allows you to CD into an object, and then you can find out what's in that object, all its methods. It would show instance variables if they were there and invisible. And you can basically act as if you were that object. So self is the object that you CD into. So CD in Pry is basically the same thing as instance eval in Ruby. So it allows you to execute arbitrary code in the context of an object. So, like I said, often used for debugging, could be used for test scenarios, like maybe you want to disable logging or network connections in an object to run in tests, but you don't want to go to the lengths of using a whole mocking framework or something like that. You can use instance eval to break into that object and mess it up as much as you want and then test it that way. But it's also used for creating domain-specific languages, which is kind of the example I was going to show. So we'll see what that looks like. All right, so this is a domain-specific language for recipes. Recipes have ingredients. Those ingredients have names and possibly an amount. And they also have steps that you need to execute to make the recipe. So I stole this example from a blog post, but not necessarily the code. I kind of refactored the code a bit. But DSLs like this allow you to create code that looks very English-like and is easy for people to understand. And it speaks in the language of the domain you're working in. So this is a DSL for creating recipes. You can see that recipes have ingredients and steps, very, very intuitive. So when we execute this, oops. Yeah, let me just get a fresh Pry again, sorry. And the name is just so I have my files in sequence of order of presentation. So. I like bourbon for my old-fashioned cocktails, so that's, I'm going to set my preferred whiskey as bourbon. And I set this in here just to show how blocks are closures. So you can see we're passing a block to this recipe.new, and down here somewhere we're accessing this preferred whiskey variable, which is defined outside of the block. That's the simplest explanation of what a closure is. So you have variables outside the block scope. They're accessible inside the block, even if that block gets bundled up into a proc object and passed to some other part of the program, and that variable goes out of scope, but still there in the block. So I can't show that latter part of what a closure is, but that shows the visibility part of it. So we have our preferred whiskey. Then I'm going to execute all this stuff. And once we've done all that, we'll print out the recipe. And this is what it ends up looking like at the end. So what I want to show with this is the way we use instance eval to kind of set up the context for this DSL so that so when we're inside the context, oh, my screen got messed up somehow. There we go. So when we're inside this block, how are these methods, ingredient and step, made available to this block here? So there's a link to the blog post that inspired this. Basics is we have a class called recipe, and recipe has a name, some ingredients, and some instructions. Initialize, as you know, is the method that gets called when you call .new on a class. It calls the initialize method and passes the arguments along. So we actually only have one real argument passed to initialize, which is the name. And then we're using the block capture syntax to grab the block that was passed in to the new method. And then we're just capturing the name that was passed in as an instance variable and initializing our ingredients and our instructions to empty arrays. And then this is what kicks off the magic here, is this instance eval. So remember that this is equivalent to self.instanceEval. In this case, self is the instance of recipe that was just created. So we're calling instanceEval and passing in this block. And by doing that, the block is effectively executing as if it were inside this instance of recipe. And so that means that this ingredient method and this step method are available to it, and that's why the block was able to call those directly. And you can see in here the ingredients just take a name and an optional amount. And keyword arguments in Ruby are pretty cool if you haven't used them. The original example used hashes for this, but I like keyword arguments better, so they're kind of fun. And then finally, the 2S method just takes all that information and prints it out. Formats it. So is it kind of clear what instance eval provides here in this example, or is that confusing?
Okay. So if you go back to the page where you were using the DSL.
Yep. What's previous? Do I have a previous?
BEP.
Oops. There we are.
So it would be equivalent if you didn't use the block syntax here. Mm-hmm. You could call old-fashioned dot ingredient for each one of those lines.
Yeah.
For each one of those lines, and it would be equivalent execution.
Yes. So what Ryan is saying is, let's say you didn't have that block. You just had called old-fashioned equals recipe.new. You could equivalently, old-fashioned dot ingredient is blah with an amount and so on. And you could keep doing that. This just saves on some syntax in this example. There are definitely more sophisticated things you could do other than just providing access to public methods, which are already public and available anyway. But this is kind of overly simplistic example. So. But at least saves some typing and reads better. Like, a lot of Ruby DSLs take the approach of passing in the DSL kind of object into a block, and then you end up doing that, like the builder example. Builder passes itself into the block, and then you end up having call like b.person and then b.name or whatever. This just saves a little typing. And in my mind, it reads better. So OK. One final slide and one final example. And they're not really related, actually. This slide, I just wanted to point out, I don't actually have an example for exec. But one problem that if you've used instance eval before, you may have run into this, that when you pass a block to instance eval, it runs in the context of some object, whatever object you call it, instance eval on. And even though the block is still a closure, it still has access to variables in its surrounding scope. It can be confusing if your block comes from one object and is executing within the other. When you access an instance variable, which one is it going to use? Is it going to be from the context that the block was created in or the context that the block is executing in, that instance eval object? Since instance eval changes what self means, Ruby chooses the latter. So instance variables are from the object that you're evaling inside of. So they're kind of the remote object, so to speak. So you don't have access to your own instance variables in your own object. If you need to do something like this, Ruby has another family of methods that are like eval, but they're called exec. You have class exec and instance exec. And they allow you to pass arguments into it, and those arguments will be forwarded along to the block so that you can kind of copy some of your scope from over here into the block when it's executing over there. So I don't think that is used very often, but I was searching around in my Ruby source folders, and RSpec uses it a lot. So there apparently must be good use cases for it if you're doing the kind of thing that RSpec does. But I did not have an example of that, but I did have one final example that kind of pulls a lot of things together. But before I get into it, are there any questions about what we've covered? Nope. Okay, so last example is just something I came up with. Python has this concept called docstrings. Like, you can put a string in your Python method, and that string gets used as the documentation for that method. And Ruby does similar things with RDoC. You can put comments before your methods and use the RDoC tool to produce an HTML documentation, but it's not available at runtime like it is in Python. So I just kind of wanted to come up with a little toy example to see how we could use some of the techniques we've talked about to provide doc strings in Ruby. And the idea was that you would just have this little doc method call before each method, and that would be used as the documentation string for that method. If we had others, doc. And so the idea here is that the doc string corresponds to the next method to be defined. And then at runtime, if you wanted to get that information out, you could call on the class, you could call docstring and pass it the method name that you want the docstring from. So this turned out to be surprisingly tricky. It seems very simple in use, but it actually took some tricks that I didn't expect. So why don't we break into that? All right, so first thing we know we need is a method called doc that takes a string. That's the one we were using. So that's what this thing here is. Doc, and it takes a string. And the behavior of that method is that it's supposed to store the string you pass it as the documentation for the next method to be defined. But since that method hasn't been defined yet, where are you going to put that? And by extension, how do you end up knowing when that method does get defined to actually do something with it? So I'm actually going to look at the second line first here, this line here. All we're doing is just saving the doc string for a future reference. Someone calls doc, we're just going to save the string they passed as an instance variable effectively. So we've got this adder accessor for this pending doc stream. So we're just putting that in there. But in order to apply that doc string to some method, we have to know that, all right, some method just got defined, so let's take this pending doc string and apply it to that method. Well, Ruby has a bunch of hook methods in it that tell you when interesting things happen, like this module was just included into some class, or this class was just inherited by some other class. One of the hooks that we have available to us is method added. So I'm going to use that to kind of hook into the life cycle here and figure out when a method gets defined. So I've got this install hooks method here. And so let's see. This is, you can't see it yet, but these, the doc method is actually being called in the context of a class, as we saw, right? It's not on some individual object, but it's kind of like at the class scope. So what we're doing here is we want to install this hook to say, all right, I'm in some class right now, and I'm trying to document some method that's about to be defined. I need to know when that method was defined on this particular class. So that's what this is doing. So kind of recall that as we're executing here, the current class is the class that called the doc method in the first place. So in our previous example usage, that was the class called document. So here we're saying, well, if we've already installed the hooks, we don't need to do anything. And we make sure to mark the fact that we did install the hooks here in the end. But here's where we do the actual hooking in. All right, so the hook method that Ruby calls is the method added hook. And it will pass along the method name. And it calls this on the class where the method was defined. So we kind of want to break into that class and define a method on it. So we're using the class eval thing here. So we mentioned class eval. And it's not exactly apparent what self here is. But remember, it's equivalent to self.classeval. And if we think way back to the beginning, self in this case is going to be our document class. So we're calling class eval on our document class and passing this block to it. In this block, we're defining the method added hook. So inside here, we'll just document this. Self equals document. In this example only, it's actually whatever class called the doc method in the first place. And Ruby will call method added with the method name. And in here, self is still that document. But remember that blocks being closures have access to their scope. So even though inside of here self is document, we can still call, trying to convince myself that that's true. We can call apply pending here, which is defined in our class, not the calling class. So does that seem a little confusing, maybe? We're kind of like splitting two contexts here. One is the document class, the calling class, and the other is this module where we're defining these methods in the first place.
Did you include the module, or did you extend it?
I included in the object class down here, so it makes it available to all objects in Ruby. So
there.
But it's still a closure. It's just that the idea of self gets confused. So apply pending, I'm pretty sure that if the document class or whatever class was calling this had an apply pending, it would use that. But since it doesn't, it uses the one that is in scope that's closed over here. All right, so what this does then is basically we've called doc, we've saved off that string that's going to be the documentation, and by installing this hook, Ruby is going to call this method here the next time a method gets added to that class. So first thing we did is save off our string, then we get notified that this method was added. It calls this hook, which in turn calls apply pending, and here is where we kind of make the association between the doc string and the method. So we check to see if we have a pending doc string first, and if we do, we just add it to this hash. It's a mapping of method names to their doc string. And then once we've done that, we just clear out the pending doc string because we've done what we needed to with it. And finally, we have a doc string method that just takes a method name, and basically all it does is reach into that hash to pull it out. So that's a pretty simple concept that took some surprising twists in how to implement it. And even though this might not be directly useful, I was thinking about using a similar technique to, like, Clojure has this concept of metadata that you can attach to any function, and they have code processing tools that use that metadata in interesting ways. Like, you can attach preconditions and postconditions, and documentation strings are kind of handled through that metadata system. And this could definitely be generalized into a generic sort of metadata attached to methods thing using the same kind of techniques. So you just define what your metadata is and then use these kind of hooks to say, all right, the next method that gets defined, attach this metadata to it. And so that's kind of where the idea was going with this, but just took one simple example. So, and I think that's it, but I don't think I showed it actually working. So let's just make sure I'm not lying about anything. So we'll load that into our environment. Here's our document class that uses the doc method. And then if all goes well here, this should say save the document. And it does. Bravo. So that's that. Yeah. I originally didn't do that. I put it as a method in module, I think. But something was causing that not to work. And I actually got it to work, but it was more complicated, and I didn't want to go into the reasons why it had to be done that way, so I just took the easy road out and put it globally accessible in Object. So
that's the Rails way, right?
Yeah. There are better ways to accomplish that, but I don't want to go into them. So, all right. So, sorry, I know that was a lot of stuff, and I apologize. I never did a dry run of this talk, so I wasn't sure how long it was going to go and what parts might be interesting or not. But I hope at least you found something in there new and interesting to you. So,